welcome you to this next e-lecture of microbiology. The topic is trypanosoma. As you all know, currently we are studying the parasitology section, and from parasitology section the important part, protozoa. The parasite protozoa are being covered. So again, these are the important examples of protozoal parasites, and among these important examples, today's topic is trypanosoma. The Leishmania has been already covered in the previous lecture. So in today's lecture we will be covering the following points: what are trypanosomes or trypanosoma, the general classification and pathogenicity of trypanosomes, and the laboratory diagnosis of the diseases caused by trypanosomes. So these are the taxonomical aspects of the hemoflagellates. So hemoflagellates of medical importance belong to the phylum Euglenozoa. The class is Kinetoplastida. Order is Trypanosomatida. Family is Trypanosomatidae, and the important genera included in this family, or the important genera in which hemoflagellates are being classified, are Leishmania and Trypanosoma. So Leishmania has been already covered in your previous lectures. So for Leishmania, you should be knowing what are the important members of the genus Leishmania, what are the diseases caused by the parasite Leishmania, the Kala-Azar, visceral leishmaniasis, cutaneous leishmaniasis, and all. So here are the diagrammatic representations of the different morphological forms of trypanosomes. These are the commonly seen morphological forms of trypanosomes. Remember that all these forms will not be seen at the given time. At given point of time, any one of these morphological forms will be observable. So four different types are there: amastigote, promastigote, epimastigote, and tripomastigote. So all these four types are based on the position of the kinetoplast, or simply the origin of the flagella. As you know, these are flagellates, and these are called hemoflagellates because these reside in blood. Principally they reside in blood and some other tissues. So hemoflagellates, they are having flagella, and the origin of flagella is the basis of differentiating different forms of trypanosoma. So first is amastigote, because it is not having flagella. The literal meaning of the word mastigote is whip. So you can see the whip like structure, the similarity of appearance of the mastigote forms to a whip. So the flagella and the body, it looks like whip. So second form is promastigote, third is epimastigote, and fourth is tripomastigote. This is the most important form, and this is the basis on which the parasites have been given the name trypanosoma. So before going to or starting with the today's topic, we should cover some basic definitions of infectious diseases, some of the types of infectious diseases which are related to today's topic, that is vector-borne disease and zoonotic disease. So infectious diseases, some of the infectious diseases are either vector-borne or zoonotic, and very few are both. So we will see what these are. Vector-borne disease are human illnesses caused by parasites, viruses, and bacteria that are transmitted by vectors. So the transmission of the pathogen is by vectors. The pathogen may either be parasite or virus or bacteria, but these pathogens are transmitted by vectors. And what are vectors? Vectors are living organisms that can transmit infectious pathogen between humans or from animals to humans. So these are the vectors. Vectors are generally belonging to the group Arthropoda or the insects. So many of these vectors are blood-sucking insects for humans and animals. So while they take blood meals, they transmit the pathogen from one human being to other human being or from animals to human beings. So these are vector-borne diseases, and zoonotic diseases are actually the diseases which are naturally circulated in animals only, not in human beings. Human beings are the accidental victims of these diseases. The natural cycle of the disease, the pathogen, is naturally circulated in animals, and human beings become accidental victims. So these are the zoonotic diseases. So let's see some examples. Like malaria. Malaria is a parasitic disease. The pathogen is Plasmodium, and it is a vector-borne disease, not a zoonotic disease. The vector is a mosquito. And leptospirosis, which is a bacterial disease, it is a zoonotic disease, not a vector-borne disease. So you should know that difference, which one is a vector-borne disease, which one is a zoonotic disease. And always remember that pathogen is different from vector. And third example, plague, which is example of both. That is zoonotic disease, because this disease comes to human beings from rats. And it is also a vector-borne disease, because the transmission is caused by rat flea. So plague is both zoonotic as well as vector-borne. The same is the condition about today's topic, vector-borne as well as zoonotic. So these are some of the important hemoflagellates or blood protozoa, importantly, blood protozoa of major clinical significance. Following genera are important: Leishmania, already covered in previous topic; Trypanosoma, important members Trypanosoma brucei and Trypanosoma cruzi; Plasmodium, Toxoplasma and Babesia, out of which first two are hemoflagellates and rest are not flagellates. So these will be covered in the subsequent lectures: Plasmodium, Toxoplasma and Babesia. So hemoflagellates, we are covering today the Trypanosoma. So what are trypanosomes or trypanosoma? So two important members are there in the trypanosomes or trypanosoma: African and American, depending on the geographical distribution of these parasites. They have been given the name African trypanosomes and American trypanosomes. In African trypanosomes, the important member is Trypanosoma brucei. There are three different types: Trypanosoma brucei rhodesiens, Trypanosoma brucei gambiens and Trypanosoma brucei brucei. So Trypanosoma brucei rhodesiens is the causative agent of East African sleeping sickness. Trypanosoma brucei gambiens is causative agent of West African sleeping sickness. And Trypanosoma brucei brucei causes Najana, a disease affecting cattle in Africa. So all these are endemic in African countries, out of which first two, rhodesiens and gambiens, are important for human beings as they cause sleeping sickness in human beings. The third member, brucei brucei, is endemic in animals. The American trypanosomes, that is Trypanosoma cruzi, only one important example. Trypanosoma cruzi is the causative agent of South American trypanosomiasis, which is also called as Chagas disease. So first we will see the African trypanosomiasis. So here you can see the geographical distribution of African trypanosomiasis. The blue colored patches are for West African trypanosomiasis, and the yellow colored patches are for East African trypanosomiasis. So principally, African trypanosomiasis is quite limited to the African continent. So these are the important types or members of the African trypanosomiasis. और अफ्रीकन ट्रिपैनोसोम्स, गैम्बियंस एंड रोडेशियंस। द ह्यूमन इन्फेक्शन इज कॉज्ड बाय बाइट ऑफ अ वेक्टर दैट इज सेसे फ्लाई, दैट इज साइलेंट सेसे फ्लाई, द साइंटिफिक नेम इज ग्लॉसिना। एंड द इन्फेक्टिव फॉर्म ऑफ द पैरासाइट इज मेटासाइक्लिक ट्राइपोमैस्टिगोस। सो द ट्राइपोमैस्टिगोट फॉर्म ऑफ द पैरासाइट इज द इन्फेक्टिव फॉर्म। एंड इन ह्यूमन बॉडी द हैबिटेट एंट्री ऑफ द पैरासाइट इन ह्यूमन बॉडी इज फर्स्ट एट कनेक्टिव टिश्यू बिकॉज ऑफ द बाइट ऑफ द फ्लाई। देन फ्रॉम कनेक्टिव टिश्यू इट इन्वेड्स लिम्फ नोड्स थ्रू लिम्फेटिक्स, देन इन्वेड्स ब्लड स्ट्रीम, गेट्स सर्कुलेटेड इन बॉडी एंड फाइनली लोकलाइजेस इन ब्रेन। सो इट अफेक्ट्स द सेंट्रल नर्वस सिस्टम ऑल्सो। सो ट्रिपैनोसोमा ब्रूसी, इट पासिस द लाइफ साइकिल इन टू डिफरेंट होस्ट, दैट इज मैन एंड डोमेस्टिक एनिमल्स, एंड इंटरमीडिएट होस्ट बींग द सेसे फ्लाई ग्लॉसिना। हियर यू कैन सी द डायग्रामेटिक रिप्रेजेंटेशन ऑफ द साइकिल, लाइफ साइकिल ऑफ द पैरासाइट ट्रिपैनोसोमा ब्रूसी। सो द इन्फेक्टिव फॉर्म आर मेटासाइक्लिक ट्राइपोमैस्टिगोट्स ट्रांसमिटेड टू मैन बाय द बाइट ऑफ सेसे फ्लाई। So these get converted, these long slender trypomasticate forms multiply by binary fission and get converted to short stumpy forms. So these get circulated in blood, these are again taken up by the sessile fly and transmitted to another victims. This is another representation of the life cycle of the Trypanosoma brucei. So here you can see the two parts, the one half cycle in sessile fly and half cycle in human beings. So this is the comparison between Trypanosoma brucei gambiens and Trypanosoma brucei rhodesiens. So here you can see the disease is named according to the geographical region it is present in, that is West African sleeping sickness and East African sleeping sickness. The vector is same and the human illness may differ in the duration, that is West African illness is chronic and East African is acute. These parasitic infections are not that common in India, very rarely some case reports have been reported, but still we need to study these parasites because we may encounter some cases of such parasites in future. So this is the vector which is responsible for transmission of the parasite. This is another picture. So remember that this is the sessile fly which transmits the parasite from one subject to another subject during its blood meals. So now what is the disease? Sleeping sickness. So because of the bite of the sessile fly, there is a development of nodule at the site of entry of the parasite, that is at the site of bite, and it is called as trypanosomal chancre. This is the picture, actual picture of the bite site on a patient of sleeping sickness. You can see the nodular formation and ulcer formation at the site of bite of sessile fly over the left leg. An actual disease is divided into two stages. Stage 1 is without the CNS involvement, which is having some asymptomatic period, which is followed by systemic febrile illness and lymphadenopathy, which is called as Winterbottom's sign. There is delayed sensation to pain because of the involvement of the nervous system. There is delayed sensation to pain, so it is called as Carendel's sign. Hematologic findings will be leukocytosis, thrombocytopenia and anemia. Stage 2 disease is with the CNS invasion, so central nervous system is invaded or parasite starts growing or multiplying in the central nervous system. So here there is characteristic progressive daytime somnolence. That is the important feature, and that's why the disease is called as sleeping sickness. So daytime somnolence. Why there is daytime somnolence? Because the sleeping cycle is disturbed, because there is restlessness and insomnia at night. The sleep is disturbed at night because of increased prostaglandin D2 level in the body. So the person, the patient is unable to sleep in the nights, hence there is daytime somnolence. As the disease progresses, there is behavioral and personality changes with apathy, confusion, fatigue and loss of coordination. So these are the clinical features of the disease. When the clinician may suspect that the person might be suffering from sleeping sickness, how to confirm the diagnosis? So by the laboratory diagnosis, we can confirm whether it is trypanosomal infection or not. So it can be done by direct microscopy, which detects the trypomastigote forms in serial blood sample examination. So peripheral blood smear examinations are prepared, stain preparations, generally Jimsa stain or any Romanowski stain can be used. Remember that serial blood samples are important. Only one sample is generally not adequate, so multiple samples may be required. CSF examination can also be done, and lymph node aspirates can also be used. Antibodies and antigen detection can also be done from serum as well as CSF. By various methods, we can detect antibodies or antigens in the patient's serum and CSF also. Molecular methods can also be used, that is detection of the genetic material by PCR and some other methods. Culture can also be done, but again, as this is a parasite, the culture is difficult and very rarely used in the basic laboratories. Animal inoculation can also be done. The experimental animal used is mice. So this is the laboratory diagnosis for Trypanosoma brucei. So this is the peripheral blood smear examination. That's direct microscopic examination of the trypomastigote forms of Trypanosoma brucei in peripheral blood. This is the Jimsa stain. Here is lying the parasite, trypomastigote form. So you can see the whip-like structure, trypomastigote. Here you can see the flagella. So this one is a thin smear, and on the right, image B, is the thick smear. So here RBCs are lysed, and the parasite is very clearly seen, very easily identified in thick smear. Again, the trypomastigote form in Jimsa stain smear, peripheral blood smear examination. Now the treatment part. If the laboratory diagnosis is confirmed, the drugs used for treatment of African sleeping sickness are pendimedrin and suramin. So that is all about Trypanosoma brucei. Now we move to Trypanosoma cruzi. First of all, the epidemiology part. The Chagas disease is mainly restricted to South and Central American countries like Brazil, Argentina, Venezuela, etc. So first, Trypanosoma brucei was African, and Trypanosoma cruzi is American. Currently, it is estimated that 16.8 million people are infected with Trypanosoma cruzi. The annual incidence is around 2 lakh new cases per year, with 50,000 deaths. So that is the burden of the disease, again in American countries. It is a zoonotic disease having many animal reservoirs like dogs, cats and rodents. So it is a zoonotic disease as well as vector borne disease. So you can remember the example lightly. So this is the geographical distribution, the red part for Chagas parasite Trypanosoma cruzi. Now the morphological forms. In vertebrate host, that is in human beings, it exists mainly in two forms, trypomastigote form and amastigote form. And in insect vector, the vector for Chagas disease is Reduvid bug. In Reduvid bug, it exists as trichomastigote and epimastigote form. So this is the diagrammatic representation. This one is a mastigote that is having no flagella, and this one is the trichomastigote that is having the flagella. Remember that the routinely used terms for parasites, protozoal parasites, that is cyst and trophozoite, are not used in relation to trypanosoma. So here the terms are different. Try to remember the terms. In now the life cycle, here you can see the diagrammatic representation. What important point is to remember that again metacyclic trichomastigote are the infective forms, and these are transmitted to human beings by rubbing of the reduvid bug feces on skin. So it is not transmitted to human beings through the bite. The bugs do bite to human beings for their meals, but the parasite is transmitted to human beings through the feces. While taking the meals, the bugs defecate on the skin, and this feces is rubbed over the skin because of the itching at the site of the bite. So we will see the transmission in a short animated video in the subsequent slides. So these metacyclic trichomastigotes get transferred in subcutaneous tissue, and then they get converted in amastigote forms and they multiply. So the short stubby trichomastigote forms are taken up again by the reduvid bug and transmitted to other subjects or other victims. And the long slender trichomastigote forms invade various organs in body, in human body. So this is the image of the reduvid bug, which is the vector for the disease. The portal of entry of this pathogen is either through skin or through conjunctiva. Many a times when eyes are rubbed with the contaminated hands, the parasite may enter inside through conjunctiva. So Trypanosoma cruzi passes its life cycle in two hosts, man and the reduvid bug. This is the another image of the reduvid bug. This is also known as triatomine bug, that is another name. So remember both the names, reduvid bug as well as triatomine bug. This is the vector and not the pathogen responsible. Always remember, vector and pathogen are two different things. So pathogenesis and clinical feature of the Chagas disease. The early stage disease, the first sign is Chagoma, this which is the inflammatory reaction at the site of the bite. And if the entry of the parasite is through conjunctiva, the patient will be showing the Romanus sign, that is the unilateral swelling of the eyelid along with the conjunctivitis because of the entry of the pathogen in that one eye through conjunctiva. So that is called as Romanus sign. Remember this name, Romanus sign. Acute Chagas, the details in subsequent slide. Here another picture of the Romanus sign when the entry of the pathogen is through conjunctiva, unilateral swelling of the eyelids along with conjunctivitis, and when the entry is through skin, there is development of this inflammatory nodule or inflammatory reaction called as Chagoma. So these are the clinical features observed in acute and chronic stages of the Chagas disease. In acute stage, the patient will suffer from fever, hepatosplenomegaly, lymphadenopathy, vomiting, diarrhea, tachycardia and similar symptoms. In chronic duration of the disease, patient will suffer from cardiovascular symptoms like palpitations, arrhythmias, chest pain. Patient may also suffer from dyspnea and some GIT related symptoms, mainly related to the esophagus because of the development of the parasite, involvement of the various important body organs in this parasitic development. Now, how to confirm the diagnosis? So, these are the various modes by which the Trypanosoma cruzi infection can be confirmed. So, peripheral blood microscopy can be done. It can be done by both ways, wet mount preparation as well as stained preparation for thick and thin smear, which will detect the trichomastigot, which are typically C-shaped and the average size is 20 micrometer. Culture is very rarely used. Triple N medium, which is the culture medium used for growing this parasite in vitro. Here you can observe the epimastigote forms of the parasite grown outside the body, that is in lab. Antibody detection as well as antigen detection can be done. Antibody is detected in serum by various ways like ELISA, indirect immunofluorescence assay, immunofluorescence assay, Western blot test and some other tests. Antigen detection can be done in serum as well as urine. Molecular methods can definitely be used, but these are used at research level facilities only. That is the detection of the genetic material of the parasite, that is polymerase chain reaction. Animal inoculation, as similar to Trypanosoma brucei, mice can be inoculated and the pathogenicity of the parasite can be observed in the experimental animals. Xenodiagnosis is an important feature where the parasite is detected from the redweed bugs. The suffering subject or the suffering experimental animal is exposed to the vector, that is redweed bug, and the vector is then examined for the presence of the parasite. Now here is a slight short video of the motility of the parasite, motile forms of the parasite, that is Trypanosoma trichomastigotes in blood. So three different wet mounts will be seen over here. First is fresh blood wet mount. So here in the center, inside the circle, you can see the motile form of the parasite by the virtue of the presence of the flagella. The parasite is motile and all these red colored cells are actually the RBCs. So this one is the motile form. Now this is the second wet mount. Here you can see various trypanosomes. The number is more because this is a centrifuged sample. So the parasites have been concentrated, the number has been increased. And this is the thin. Here you can see two trypanosomes swimming at the bottom of the collector tube. So these are the trypanosomal parasites, trichomastigote forms, in blood mount. And this is a short video about the life cycle of the parasite. So Chagas disease. So this is the bug, redweed bug, which is responsible for transmission of this parasite, also known as triatomine bug. So here it is taking the blood meal on the subject. So while taking its meals, it defecates over the skin. At the site of bite, because of the itching, there is scratching, and because of the scratching, the parasite present in the feces of the redwood bug gets inoculated in the skin. So here you can see the trichomastigote forms, which will gain entry in the human body cells. Here they will get converted in amastigote forms, that is they will lose their flagella and they start multiplying. After multiplication, they again get converted into trichomastigote forms and get circulated in blood. So in blood, they will lodge in various important body organs, including the heart muscles, cardiac muscle cells. Here you can see the parasite coming and getting lodged in the cardiac muscle. Here they multiply again in the ermastigote forms, and after multiplication they get converted into trypomastigote forms and again get circulated in the blood. Because of the development of the parasite, there is scar tissue development in the cardiac muscles. So here you can see the images. The image A is of Trypanosoma cruzi trypomastigote form in thin blood smear. So this is a GIMSA stain smear. You can see the RBCs, and along with the RBCs here, this is the trypomastigote form of Trypanosoma cruzi. In the image B, you can see many ermastigote forms shown by this arrow in cardiac muscles. So this is HNE stain smear of cardiac muscles. Image C is indirect fluorescent antibody test showing the trypomastigote forms. So here you can see the flagellated trypomastigote forms. Image D is the epimastigote form which is seen from culture. So in vitro growth of the parasite will show these epimastigote forms. Now the last part, treatment part. So for treatment, the drugs which are used for Trypanosoma cruzi infection, that is Chagas disease, are benznidazole, nifurtimox and allopurinol. So these are the different drugs which are used for Chagas disease treatment. So we will end this session with this famous quote of Theodore Roosevelt. Thank you for your patient listening. Stay home, stay safe.